Welcome to the latest session with ANN Connect, powered by Anime NYC. I'm your host, Lynzee Loveridge, and I'm excited to announce that we have an extra special guest today. He's no stranger to anime. He has brought his fandom both on and off the field, including charging up at Kamehameha in the end zone and appearing in the Crunchyroll documentary, He Was Anime, the Mike Daniels story. We're excited to have huge anime fan and a terror on the field, Cincinnati Bengals defensive tackle, Mike Daniels, here today. So I wanted to thank you for joining us today in the midst of what is probably like a really unusual football season. So I was wondering, what's your schedule like right now? Do you have time to watch anime?
So right now, yes, I do. Actually, I have all the time to watch anime because my team didn't make it to the playoffs. So I'm home. I have nothing but time on my hands, and I'm spending that time, we're homeschooling the kids and watching anime. Typical off season in the Daniels household.
Yes. Yes, that sounds like my typical work day too. You know,
right.
You start working in anime. That's all I'm doing. So I was so you are squeezing time to watch an anime between all your responsibilities. What are you watching right now?
So right now, gosh, Attack on Titan, the final season, came out. Now, about 4 years ago, Oh my gosh, 5 years ago, I started reading the manga. I got ahead. Then Toonami got it, and I said, oh, it ain't going to catch up. Before I knew it, I looked up, and oh my God, there goes the Beast Titan. They caught up to me, then they passed me. So, like, if I jump into the manga first, I can't go back to the anime until I finish the manga. You see what I'm saying? So right now, I'm getting back into reading the manga so that I can watch the final chapters and actually enjoy them, because I want to see what was changed in the anime, you know, because even spot was changed in the anime.
The book first before watching the movie sort of situation,
same exact thing. That's what I'm doing right now. Really Attack on Titan right now. I got a whole list of stuff that I want to see Doro Hedoro, you know what I mean? Netflix. Right. In fact, it's funny because I actually pulled this list up because I was going to, I have a list of anime that, God, I just keep adding to it. I'm such a slacker.
Like a spreadsheet.
Yeah, so I got Digimon 2020, Burn the Witch, which I believe is a manga, Samurai 8, Act Rage, Jujutsu Kaisen, which a bunch of my teammates told me about.
You gotta watch that.
And a whole bunch of stuff. I'm not about to drive everybody crazy with it, you know. But
so that's all the comics, like the manga comics you're reading right now, right? Is what you're saying?
Well, those are the ones that I'm starting. Those are the ones I'm starting, and then going to go to their anime adaptations, when I finish the manga.
Those are all running in Shonen Jump, I think, right?
Yep. I'm a big Shonen fan, you know, typical, right? But yeah, I'm a big Shonen fan. I was really happy when the Shonen Jump came to the States. I was in eighth grade. A lot of people had no idea what it was, and I was like, you guys don't understand. This is what made Dragon Ball Z so popular, you know, this magazine right here. So I'm really happy Viz localized it, and Viz has been doing a phenomenal job. Them and Funimation, just two great companies. And the other anime, I caught COVID January 1st. What a way to start the new year, right? A way to start the new year. You know, COVID, and I had to quarantine away from the team and everybody. I missed the last game of the season. And while I was quarantined in the hotel, I watched Seven Deadly Sins.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yep, watched Seven Deadly Sins, and something didn't look right. I'm looking at, you know, the screen caps of the episodes of the future, and I'm like, I don't feel like this is about to end. And
it's still going. I think it's
exactly.
It's still going.
So I'm going to jump into the manga so I can look further ahead, because who knows when it's going to get animated. And I'm definitely waiting for My Hero Academia. And those are my anime. And hopefully High Score Girl gets a third season.
Yeah. Oh, hopefully. You like that one too. Yeah.
Oh, I love that one.
Did you play a lot of fighting games? Like, are you a fan of, like, Street Fighter and stuff like that?
I am a fan of Street Fighter. I actually went back home. I went back to New Jersey, and my buddy owns a sound studio. A bunch of rappers and stuff come through, but he's a huge blurred. He's got a bunch of Transformer stuff, and he has arcade cabinets. So he has his name is Devin Wade. They got a podcast, they're hilarious. But he has Street Fighter as one of the games, and I whooped him last time with Chun-Li. So I walked in there, a bunch of rappers in there. I'm like, yeah, I beat this guy with Chun-Li. This guy's terrible. And come to find out, he was playing with his left hand. He used both hands this time. I couldn't touch him. I was so embarrassed. I didn't speak about it for the rest of the time I was there. It's pretty bad. I am a fighting game fan.
Yeah, I've got a friend who's got video game cabinets. Like, he's just been putting them in his garage, but he likes to put, like, more obscure stuff in there. Like, I think he's got, like, Bubble Bobble, like the one with the little dinosaurs. And then he's got some other one that's like a Frisbee game, I think. Something I can't remember, but he's always trying to find, like, really old cabinets and, like, obscure games and, like, stick them in there. It's fun.
Is Bubble Bobble, is that Taiko? That's not SNK. That's I forget the name of the company, but they localized to bust a move when it came to the state. Those little dinosaurs are weird.
Yeah, but you're talking about so you haven't watched Jujutsu Kaisen yet, and I'm gonna try and sell you on, like, watching it right now, because it's definitely one of the, like, best shows that's out right now. The animation is awesome, the characters are really funny, and the action scenes are, like, top tier. Like, it's really, really good.
I'm a sucker for animation, man. I think Demon Slayer has by far been one of my favorite almost of all time, because of how they perfectly caught it's a horror anime, but it's also a shonen. So they blended it perfectly, man. You know what I'm saying? They blended it so perfectly. So, like, you can crap your pants from being scared, but also say this is awesome action at the same time. Like it's really, they carry eeriness, the creepiness of it so well.
Yeah, can't wait for the monster train. Design is like really good, and then like the main villain for that show,
Michael Jackson.
I just said he's kind of sexy, like Michael Jackson. He's, you know, he's like really stylish, but you know, really intimidating at the same time. But no, like the fight they did where it was one of the earlier ones where they went into I think it was like an inn or an old house, and it had that demon that would like clap and then the room would shift.
It's a time, yeah, yep.
Yeah, that one was really cool.
It was so eerie when they were in the forest, they found the two kids. The kids are—they're scared. They're frightened of this. Of this place, right? And all of a sudden, you just hear the beating of that—I believe it's called a tatami or a drum, whatever—and you just see a dude just fly out from the top balcony. And it's just quiet, and he lands. And I'm like, God, that's so freaky, yo. That would mess me up pretty badly if I saw that. It's more like unsettling.
Yeah, or like when we first like terrified the whole time. That'd be me. I'd be like, no, we don't need to go in there. Let's just go.
We don't have to go in there. It's okay. But their brother was in there, and you know, he had to be a hero. So shout outs to him. I'm with it. Cool. Excellent.
Yeah, I can't wait till the movie makes its way over here. Because I mean, we got people in Japan who were able to go see it, but we're still waiting on it. The Mugen train.
Is there I don't know if you can disclose this or not, but is there a legal way for us to watch it subtitled?
Not yet.
Crap. No, I'm not about to risk getting you. I'm not ashamed to say I've destroyed so many laptops with viruses throughout middle school, high school, and college trying to get anime because I could not afford it. And I was doing it the same way a lot of fans did it back then. Thank God for streaming services, right?
I know. They didn't have that back in the day, and it was that, and you know, getting in trouble with like LimeWire or something, trying to download music and ending up with crap.
You get your cable shut down. Oh my God!
Parents get like a letter from Comcast or whatever telling you downloading illegal stuff. You're like, I don't know what you're talking about.
I swear to God, it was porn. Trust me, that's all, that's it. It was porn. I'm sorry.
It's more honorable just to own up to porn than to say that you're trying to download Japanese cartoons off the internet.
Right. Funny how times change. I would rather say I was watching porn than anime. Now, you know, everybody loves anime and it's popular, and I really enjoy where we at right now as an anime community.
Yeah, because, you know, when I was growing up, anime was still, like, really nerdy, and it could actually be hard to find people to, like, geek out with. And so I was wondering, like, when you were growing up, were you like an incognito fan, or were you in like an anime club in high school, or did you have like other nerdy friends you could talk about it with? Or
I had the friends that I have now, we became friends because we all were video game and anime fans. I mean, these guys were in my wedding. That's how close we are, right? To this day. So I found my group. You know, and it's funny because we're all completely different. You know what I'm saying? Like different hobbies, interests outside of anime, and anime is really what brought us together. And it's really cool. You know what I'm saying? It's really cool. We watch anime to the day. We have a good group chat where we're definitely talking about different anime theories and stuff. What was that? I'm sorry.
Oh, it's like you guys are all on Discord or something like that, chatting about it, or.
Actually, we just started one of the guys started a Discord. A channel? Last year for us all to get on there and talk some smack, you know. So one of the guys, this poor guy, because this will never happen now. He's been trying to get us to watch One Piece since like 2006, and
you can't now
because
it's like 900
episodes. I know. I feel so bad for them because nobody's going to do it now because they just eclipsed 1,000 episodes. Yeah. And the manga, good Lord, it's like that thing's like the Bible. Are you kidding me? It ain't ending. Like, golly. So
trying to get you guys to jump on that pirate ship with him. And then now it's just like, it's too big.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
He got the cliff notes or something.
There are no cliff notes. But he said you can literally start at any point in the story and get caught up, which is mind blowing to me. But we have 1,000 episodes, because they say One Piece has such a great really fleshed out giant world.
Yeah.
Every character serves a purpose. There's just no fluff. There's a reason why it's been number one until, you know, the last couple years in manga and anime. There's a reason.
Yeah, Demon Slayer is the first thing to kind of try and like grapple with it for that spot. But I mean, it's definitely been ruling the manga scene for a really long time. We've got a guy named Grant, who reviews that for us. And I mean, the latest arcs, it looks really cool. It's kind of based on the legend of Momoji. It's a Japanese folktale about like a boy who's, it reminds me a little bit of like Thumbelina, but it's a boy who's like born out of a peach, right? Like he's raised by like two elderly people who find him, and he grows up to be like a warrior, and he ends up taking like a dog, a bird, and a third animal with him, and goes to like a journey to the Oni, you know, the ogre island, and starts defeating all the ogres and stuff. So it's kind of like based around that legend.
Are the two primary ogres blue and red? Because they always are.
Yeah.
See, I freaking knew it. So that's what makes anime so great, right? And I'm about to lush real quick. I'm sorry. I know you got. I'm excited.
It's okay.
I've been following.
Just going with the flow on this.
Listen, like, I've been following Anime News Network for a very, very, very since dial up. All right. So I'm very excited. but yeah, that's what makes anime. That's one thing I really appreciate about anime. It makes it so unique as a medium is that they are very like culturally in tune. Like there are so many characters that are based off of different Oni or folklore or just a whole bunch of different aspects of the Japanese culture. Like there are so many Pokemon that are based off of Japanese folklore.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And the different Oni and Yokai watch, that's all it is. It's a bunch of you learn about a bunch of Japanese ghosts and spirits. You see what I'm saying? So it's really I really do enjoy the medium that's one of the bigger reasons why I enjoy the medium, because of once you learn about, oh, this guy is actually based off of like a Super Saiyan is based off like the golden warrior of legend. You know what I mean? A lot of, that's like, oh wow, I didn't know that. And there's just so many different references and things like that in anime, man, that it really makes you like appreciate the culture as a whole.
Yeah.
You know,
like I really like ghost stories, right? Like I really like spooky stuff in general. So like yokai is like something that I really like, and I like cats, and there's a lot of yokai like based around cats, like the ones with two tails and stuff like that. The trickster type, where you see a lot of characters based on the fox, the shape-shifting fox characters. Those show up a lot.
So the more you
learn about the country, you can appreciate different parts of the entertainment. It's really fun.
Yeah. Absolutely. And it's just so funny. Like, I never thought, like, okay, you know, I got Vulpix, and I got Ninetales. Yeah. Then I got the fox in Shaman King. You know, then I got the fox, Naruto. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I'm like, there might be something culturally significant to a fox, particularly if it has nine tails and it shoots fire. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So,
right.
But you mentioned horror and cats. I'm sure you're a fan of Junji Ito, correct?
Yes. Yes. I have a shelf over here that you can't see that has all of his English releases on it, on a shelf. So, yeah.
Nice. I'm a fan. So you know he has what a story about his cat.
I do. Yeah, Yawn and Moo. I've also got a t-shirt with his cats on it.
Nice.
I have a t-shirt that has cats on it. And it's got like a heavy metal style font, and it just says meow, but it looks like really intimidating. I like it. Yeah, Crunchyroll sold that. I had to get it.
I can't wait for the dang Uzumaki to come out. It's like they've been talking about it for a couple years now. I'm like, I need to see this. I need to see this animated.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I'm really excited about it because they also got the composer.
Hellstar Romina. Oh no, not that. Excuse me.
Oh no, but yeah, I just read that recently too. But
that's a good
Hellstar Romina. Yeah, it is. They got the composer for the Uzumaki anime. It's the same guy who did Hereditary, which I don't know if you watched that movie. That movie is really freaking weird.
I haven't saw it. I've seen a lot about it. I'm really scared to see it, but I'm gonna see it anyway. as an excuse to jump into my wife's arms. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Oh, it'll trip you out. It's unlike any horror movie I'd ever seen. And it's the same guy that went on to do Midsommar, which was also like.
Is his name Colin Stetson? Is that his name?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, he's like the Hans Zimmer of horror movies now.
Yeah.
Seriously.
Yeah. So the fact that I got him for this project got me really, really excited. Yeah.
Yeah. Nah. See, there's certain things with anime where, when people are watching it or they're reading the manga, they forget. Oh, I'm watching a cartoon. I'm reading a comic book. And I feel like when you have people like Colin Stetson who can, you know, perfectly catch that atmosphere that Junji Ito is creating in his manga, somebody will watch that and realize, they'll forget, oh my God, I'm watching a black and white comic book turned into a cartoon. Yeah. They're going to say, oh my goodness, this is a scary ass story.
They're like, pause it. I got to come back later.
Right, I think I saw it myself. Yeah, exactly.
Right, yeah. So I did want to ask you a little bit about your history with Dragon Ball Z, because it seems to go pretty far back. Like, you said you've read Anime News Network for a long time, and I became aware of your name in about 2017 because Spencer Young drew you as a Saiyan on the Packers fence at Lombardi Avenue, and that's the first time I read the name Mike Daniels. So I was wondering how far back do you and DBZ go?
So Spencer Young, that's my guy. Shout outs to him. But as far as Dragon Ball goes back, 98 was the first time I saw it. You know, we was heading to a wrestling tournament and I saw it before we left. And I didn't know what it was. I saw this chick with blue hair. You know, there's a bunch of trees with afros on it. Green sky. I'm like, what is this? The grass is blue. And I said, it looks pretty cool. Then I seen this dude with his massive forehead, total tough guy. I'm like, okay, all right, I got to check in on this show. And I said, it really looks a lot like Sailor Moon and Pokemon. Because my sister, she's like 12 years older than me. Sailor Moon, that's you know, she's a big fan. That's why I became a fan. And then it was part of Toonami Block, obviously. But that's why I became a fan. And then Pokemon and Dragon Ball Z, I just noticed the similarities. And I said, these shows are different. You know, these are different than Spider-Man and Batman and the superhero friends one. It was like a 70s, 80s Justice one of the DC. League. Justice League, they were all called Justice League. Either
super
way.
Friends. I used to watch Super Friends.
Super Friends, that's what I was thinking about. Okay, so Super Friends. I said, this is different. I'm like, this is way, way, way different than any of the shows I'm used to seeing, and the animation was on point. And I said, okay, I like this a lot. And when Dragon Ball Z stopped, you know, showing, I'm like, yo, what the hell is this? Like, why do they keep repeating? Goku lands on Namek, knocks out one of the dudes, and it restarts. Yeah. And my cousin, who's older than me, God blank you, God, for the older nerds who paved the way for the rest of us, right? He said, hey, the comic book shot, the Echelon Mall, you know, Hall of Heroes, you can go and get the next episodes. So I went and I got it, picked up a tape, and it looked like a VHS tape, but it had like, you know, the print Vegeta Saga, I think volume 5 or something like that. I said, oh, okay. This is like a regular tape. What? This doesn't look official, but it's cool. Fine. I plugged it in, and first of all, I see like the quality looks kind of crazy. I'm like, okay, it's not as sharp as TV. It's cool. It was in Japanese.
Oh, okay.
I said, oh my God, this is crazy. I have to read the words. Right. You know, and it was a fan sub, and oh my goodness, I absolutely loved it. First of all, I'm like, there I see blood, Raccoon's ass is hanging out. I'm like, what's going on? This is crazy. You know what I'm saying? And they're talking about people dying.
Yeah.
I'm like, what about the next mention? What is this?
Yeah, see, so, they used to censor it like that. Yeah,
so
they're
going to. And I'm glad.
I think they did the same thing in Yu-Gi-Oh! Too.
Yeah, the Shadow Realm. Ooh, if you fall through the glass, you fall through the Shadow Realm instead of splattering at the bottom of the pavement, which is what really happens. These are energy discs. No, their blades are going to cut your freaking ankles off. Okay, if you. I got fooled by the Shadow Realm too, I must admit.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't get fooled by the Shadow Realm until I saw that. But that's what really
I thought it was the Negaverse. I totally thought it was the Negaverse until like I got the legit, because even with Sailor Moon, even with the comics, like they had all the names and stuff changed in the comic books too. So it was like the Negaverse and
Hold on.
Mega Kingdom.
I was today years old when I realized the Negaverse was not a thing.
Oh no, it's really the Dark Kingdom is what it's called.
Okay, yeah. So yeah. Okay, I hear about the Dark Kingdom. So the Negaverse was
that was just a dub term that they used. Yeah.
Oh. Yeah. Oh boy. I feel stupid. I just explained to my kids like Brock's donuts, jelly-filled donuts. Like, right. No, son, those are rice cakes, rice patties. It's a,
yeah,
you know, it's not, those aren't donuts. And now they're like interested in seeing the stuff that gets changed. But I thought it was really cool to see, like, wow, there are two versions of my favorite show. And this is the version I want to see because I want to see the creator's original intent. I don't want to see what's changed, or I want to see the creator's original intent. And that's when I started to really dive deep. I started getting all the fan subs and everything. I got ahead of, you know, a television and whatnot. And I really, really just, that just piqued my interest so much, even at 10 years old, you know? And I'm like, this is dope. You know what I mean? I need to get more of this. Yeah. I need to see. What else is happening to these other shows from Japan? What else is being changed? Then I was able to start noticing like, okay, that scene got edited out. Okay, they slowed that down for the flashing light. Like, I just, yeah. I really just took a big interest in the changes, the censorship. Yeah. The I was like, I need to see the original copies. And then once I started seeing, like, then I noticed like the gratuitous swearing. Like, I would watch Fist of the North Star and I said, okay, I'm sure they didn't swear that. Like, they did not drop the F bomb this many times. They dropped the F bomb at all, if there is one. You know what I'm saying? So,
right.
I wanted to see the original script. I wanted to know what the show, what was the author really trying to portray? Right. Goku's not, yes, he's technically Japanese Superman, but he ain't Superman. He's a guy, he's a country bumpkin who loves to fight.
Yeah.
See what I'm saying? He's not stupid. He's just a little naive. You know what I'm saying? Like, the country dude who loves to fight. Shout out to my country dudes. You know what I mean? They're awesome. They're great. That's why everybody loves Goku. He's the every guy. He's the everyday guy. He's the average dude. Loves to fight. You know, he eats and loves to eat.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, so I he's not some sanctimonious, I'll light a good nightmare for you. No, that's not Goku. You know what I'm saying? That was a moment where he took the time to fully come to terms with, I am Super Saiyan Son Goku. You know what I'm saying? Like, I am owning the fact that I'm a Saiyan from this race, and now I'm going to beat the hell out of you for what you did. See what I'm saying? Or continue to beat the hell out of you for what you did.
Right.
So
right.
It's just so much. You know, so much. And just, I'm not a purist. I'm not a dub versus sub. You know, there's some charm to the old dubs, you know, and all the goofy stuff, the cousins or whatever, Sailor Moon. But you know, when you see those dubs now, and I think Yu Yu Hakusho was the first one. Well, excuse me, Cowboy Bebop, Gundam Wing. Mm-hmm. You know, and obviously, you know, Cartoon Network, Konami Inspired. Those were the ones that I really saw. Like, okay, you can tell they stuck to the original script, the original soundtrack. They're not trying to quote unquote Americanize it for the kids, and I really just appreciated the serious tones of those shows, and that took a lot of guts for Toonami to put that on TV, a show like Gundam Wing of that serious nature, aimed towards kids.
Afternoon slot right after school. You know, you got out of get out of school around like 2:30 or something, and then you could turn on Gundam Wing, and they'd have Dragon Ball Z. They had Tenchi Muyo at one point.
Tenchi Muyo, a harem anime. Yeah. Anime, you know what I'm saying? Well, like, you got Bishoujo, or no, that's not Bishoujo. What is the girl anime, like when it's magical girl anime, right? Shonen, you have a space drama or a space opera with Gundam Wing, and you got a harem anime with Tenchi Muyo, and it's like they hit all bases. That was genius, that was genius because they had something for everybody,
it did, yeah. Yeah, and it might get you to try something like you didn't think you would like because it was on right before what you were tuning in to watch. I have to ask you, though, if you watched Tenchi Muyo, was it Ryoko or Aika for you?
Ryoko all day. Well, Patricia Bouchard, she is awesome. I'm so glad she came back to voice her again. Like, Ryoko, like, that was my heart. The first episode, and I'm like,
I appreciate, you know what I mean?
Attacking me in the school and stuff. I got speechless for a second there. You know, yeah. She was taking him to school and stuff, and I'm like, at the end of the episode when she rolls over on the bed, I'm like, the animation looks jumpy. I'm like, oh yeah, that's definitely a boob hanging out, probably.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, that's like probably like painted over a little bit. They had to put like bathing suits on them and stuff to put it on TV.
Yeah,
but, like, those bathing suits. Yeah, I like Ryoko because like she was one of the first female characters in like a romantic comedy that was like she knew what she wanted, right? She wasn't like playing coy about it, or she wasn't like super embarrassed about being attracted to a guy. She was like, yeah, I like this guy, and you're gonna be with me, and you know, like, we're going to have a good time. And like, you didn't really have that, especially not in like kids cartoons or anything. So
it definitely made it easier for me to be comfortable around my more, let's just say around my female classmates who knew what they wanted. You know what I mean?
Right.
You know, you know what I'm saying? So I'm like, okay, cool. You know, she's like, oh, cool. I like her. She's cool. You know what I mean? And Ayaka, that has a good female cast. I must say, Ayaka, she's the same way. She just goes about it differently. Ayaka is the same way.
Yeah,
you know.
And then Mushu was just like, she was just tons of fun, like up to like her scientist shenanigans, and then she was like an airhead, but she was funny too.
Definitely an airhead, man. Definitely an airhead. But Miyoshi, you know, she's funny. She's cute. And when you go later on deeper into the story, She's a lot more important to the plot.
Yeah, I was wondering if it was this whole tangled web where she might actually be like Washu's daughter through like spoilers, I guess, if people still don't know this, but like she might be Washu's daughter via like a Jirai royalty something.
Yeah.
And her brain was wiped. I don't know. It's like crazy. It's totally crazy.
God, can we just branch off Tenchi Muyo real quick? I just got a couple things to say. I'm so sorry. Washu. I mean, is she Ryoko's mom? Is she just a scientist that traveled Ryoko, Tenchi Muyo? I mean, Tenchi in universe? Or is she like, I mean, Ryoko's mom is that she created her in the lab with her own DNA.
Right.
Is she Tenchi in Tokyo, where she's literally just a scientist that's, you know, like, that's the one thing with the continuities now. Tenchi Muyo, I think that's the main storyline canon.
Yeah.
Tenchi Universe was fun.
Yes. Yeah.
Tenchi in Tokyo was odd. I was kind of like,
like Tenchi in Tokyo really as much because they introduced that other like normal girl, and I didn't want Tenchi.
Yeah, get her out of here. She's boring. We get enough normal girls. No disrespect to you or my mother or any other normal girl I know, but she's boring. I see normal girls every day. She's about to blow some shit up.
Turn into like a robot. Like they made it into like a little mecha Cabot robot in Tenchi in Tokyo. Like there's like three different timelines. It's actually even crazier than that. I'm not even prepared to like try to explain it. Cause there's like weird spin-offs too with like Tenchi's like nephew or all this other kind of stuff. And then when you start like breaking it down, like technically like Tenchi and Ayaka are actually related, and that's kind of weird.
They're distant cousins, which, well, on Jirai, they don't look down on
that kind of
taboo.
Thing.
Right. I ain't gonna speak it. But they don't look down on it because you see it like, first of all, what's the name? He's like, you know, he's got the two wives, you know what I mean? And then nobody ages. Like, I'm your great grandma, right? Well, if my great-great-grandma's alive, then why is my mom dead? You know what I'm saying? It's like, can't you give her some of that magic, dad? You know what I mean? My bad. My mom is actually a descendant of you guys, so why is she dead? And my stupid earth dad, who's hitting on all the girls. Like, oh, gosh. I'm like, yo, what is this?
Tenchi's frustrating. Yeah.
Yeah. I can see why he's always like, ah! You know, that's the noise he makes.
I just want to go to school and my life is a mess. Yeah. I kind of feel for him in that way, you know?
Oh, God.
Oh, man.
Washu did have a son, too, by the way.
What's that?
Washu did have a son.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's how it's supposed to be. Like, okay, so, like...
And she had to abandon her husband and her son.
Yeah.
She had to flee. Yep.
Right. But she's also, like, a goddess of chaos or something, too, right? Like, it's her, Tsunami... And there's a third one, I think. And the third one, like, ends up being a major player in the first part of the OVA. Yeah.
Yep. Her Tsunami and Tsunami being basically who Sasami, because Sasami died being a little kid doing something she ain't supposed to do, and Tsunami saved her life. And basically, Tsunami's like the Kurama, you know what I mean? She's like the Kurama Tsunami's the Kurama to Sasami's Naruto.
Okay.
She resides within Sasami, but you know, when it's goddess time, she comes out, and in that the last part of the series, we get to see how powerful, you know, Tsunami within Sasami is.
Yeah. I can't believe we just broke down like the Tenchi timeline. That's insane. Cause it's just,
you know what? I think there's so much stuff we left uncovered. The Tenchi purists on Reddit are going to kill us right now. What is he talking about? He doesn't know anime. I'm like, dudes, come on. We're all on the same boat. We're on the same team here. Let's have fun.
Yeah. I had noticed, you know, when I was looking some stuff up for this interview, and I mean, you know, I came across your article about you where, you know, they had the painting and everything, but then I realized like there are a lot of athletes that are like super big in anime. Like it's like mainstream for you guys now. Like the New England Patriots, they've got like an anime club and they got to tour around Anime Boston. Joel Embiid was watching Dragon Ball GT on his phone while he was getting ready to play, you know, game. And then, like, a world record holder track star, Noah Lyle, he, like, referenced Goku before he started and put, like, silver in his hair. And it's a really funny interview. Like, he was doing an interview with, like, mainstream media, and they didn't know what the heck he was talking about. And he's like, it's okay. I'll get you guys hip, is what he told them. He's like, I'll get you guys hip. Just, you know, later.
Yeah, mainstream, right?
Why do you think anime is so big with athletes? Is it just because it's big with everybody, or is there something about it that, like...
I know particularly with Shonen, bunch of young prepubescent teenage boys, they want to see a bunch of dudes fighting, a lot of testosterone. I'm going to go out there and slam dunk or tackle some dude or put somebody in the head. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I think it's the overall just crazy. So anime, the animation in anime allows the brutality and the overall super dope manliness. And testosterone just flies off the screen. Oh my God, that's a terrible image. I should not have said that. But you know what I'm saying, right?
Yeah, like, yeah. The fighting spirit is there, you know? And you're like, yeah, I feel that in here too.
Right? Everybody who has if the Dragon Ball Z Kakarot Japanese commercial where it has the dude and it shows him and his brother Dragon Ball fighting when they're kids and the older sister rolling her eyes, that was totally me and my brother. And a bunch of other dudes who I knew who had brothers doing the same thing. Throw 1,000 punches and all that. So everybody just feels like I want to be like Goku. I want to be like, you know, Vegeta, like this guy, like that guy, right?
Yeah.
And also because of the struggle they go through, it's very similar to an athlete's journey. We have to go through grueling, hellish training to be prepared for a contest, battle, whatever. We're getting ready for a game or a match, you know, or a racer. And it's like, man, I have to train like Goku. I got to train like the Saiyans. I need to go Super Saiyan. You know what I mean? I'm referencing that because most people are like, what is, or I want to be like Naruto. I got to work on my techniques and everything like that. See, and seeing the characters level up and then defeat somebody they couldn't defeat before, that's very encouraging and inspiring for an athlete.
Yeah,
I know there were some guys who, when I had to wrestle them in high school, I'm like, okay, I would recall like the battle between Guts and the one dude that the immortal horned beast.
Yeah, I know who you're talking about. Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
He threw the sword to help Guts out. You know what I'm saying? And I'm like, I remember that battle because Guts is sitting there like in the soundtrack, same soundtrack from when the army rose up when Griffith had the Behelit or whatever. I'm talking about the old. Not the new anime, right? And the same soundtrack is very eerie. I actually listen to the soundtrack before games, puts me in that mood. And Guts is like, oh my God, yo, this guy is so strong. Guts killed 100 men. He's like, yo, this guy's unbelievably strong. How am I going to fight? How am I going to survive? And I even went, how do I survive? And then he gets the inspiration from Nosferatu, and Guts realizes, oh, hold on. I just survived a battle with an immortal demon goat. Manitar thing. I can beat this dude, and then he just kills the guy easily. And as an athlete, it's like, man, how can I win this? And then you recall what you went through, whether mm-hmm. it was a previous game, wrestling match, training, and you get that like, yeah, okay, I can do this. And you just, you know, live out how your favorite characters lived it out. Also, side note, I know the guy that started the New England anime club. He's a good friend of mine, Lawrence Guy. And I remember he told me, Mike, I'm going to start an anime club. I was like, please do. Please, yeah. The guy, do. And when I read about it, I was like, yes, he did it. I was so excited.
Yeah, that was really cool. Like, they got to have, like, their own little, like, tour through Anime Boston. I was jealous. I haven't got to go to Anime Boston yet. And now, you know, I don't know when I will get to. But, yeah, it looked like they had a really great time in there. Have you visited convention, like, anime conventions before?
Oh, God, yes. Yeah. So my first one was 2003 Otakon in Baltimore, Maryland. I'm from New Jersey. Okay. And, I was on a message board, I believe, and guys were talking about this anime convention. And I'm like, what is that? They told me about it. I told my dad. Me and one of my best friends went down there, and I said, I didn't even know what cosplay was. Well, I heard of it from one of my older cousins. I've been blessed with some nerdy older cousins. This is great. Yeah. Right. And man, I said, so this is what it looks like in real life. This is awesome. See what I mean? Yeah. So much so, we went back the next year. You know, we would only go for a day, and we went back the next year, and I actually got a, you know, Chris Sabat's autograph, and I told him I played football. Yeah, and he said, good luck with football this year, Mike. He said, good luck this year, Mike. Kick football's ass. I was like, yeah! Yes, he's awesome for that. So, I just really enjoyed it. I enjoyed playing all the games. One of the new Guilty Gears was coming out. Beautiful Joe was coming out. So you got to test some of the games and stuff. They had a bunch of art, like a giant hall where like some competitive gamers, you will see at Evo, was there. And they were, I mean, these guys were unreal. Guys and girls. They were unreal. They had some DDR there. That was pretty cool. So, those are my first conventions.
To just indulge in everything that, you know, like, made you happy, like, brought you joy. Yeah. You got to do that for a whole weekend. Yeah. And everyone around you loves the same stuff, you know?
That's what I'm saying. And so here's what made it easier for me in college. Oddly enough, there was a anime convention at the hotel we stayed at during football camp. They put us away in a hotel, you know, mm-hmm. for focus groups, things like that. And Anime Iowa, because I went to the University of Iowa, Anime Iowa was held at the Marriott in Crowville, Iowa. So it always landed on the one weekend we got off. So so me and my teammates, we would, you know, go down there, go sit in on some of the shows and performances and stuff like that, man, meet other anime fans. And that's when I really got to see who on my team were anime guys, because whoever was down there was like, okay, you're a brother. Now you're a friend for life. You see what I'm saying? So that was really cool. And man, my brother and I, a bunch of our buddies, we went to Comic-Con a few years ago, and we did some cosplay as a bunch of Naruto characters. I was Raikage and he was Killer B. And it's funny because I always said that's our personalities. I'm like the serious jerk older brother, and he's like the goof off with all the talent in the world, but just wants to like rap and play around and goof around all the time. So it's like, that's just me and him. And we did that well, man. It was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun. I definitely had a lot of fun in conventions, and I'm looking forward to when they start having them again.
Yeah. Yeah. Me too. I want to make it back out to Otakon. Like, I haven't been to Otakon since 2011 or something, I think. So I want to make it back out there, 'cause I'm West Coast. So I've been going to Anime Expo the last couple of years, and that's a real fun time, but it's, you know, it's really busy. I don't know if you've ever been to AX, but like, you gotta have like your elbows out while you're trying to get anywhere. Like, it's crazy packed in there the whole time. It's like 5 days.
I want to go there so bad. I want to go.
You need like a whole week for it, like for real. But when they have it up and running, it's fun because sometimes they get like the world premiere, so you can actually like see it before everybody in Japan even gets to see it. Like,
wow.
They did that with the last season. I think it was the last season of My Hero Academia. So I got to watch like the first episode of that. And it was funny because I got to watch it. And then when it came back on TV, it was different. Like, they took the footage that we saw and actually spread it out over 3 episodes and put other stuff in between all of it to like make it longer.
Wow. Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. That, well, hey, that definitely get people to watch.
Yeah. And they have like the best concerts over at Otakon. I don't know if you got to go to a concert or not, but I was real jealous because someone got to go to, they had Yoko Kanno there.
The lady and the Seabells.
Yeah.
She's
done so many great soundtracks. And so, you know, she did Cowboy Bebop stuff. You know, she did
the real folk blues.
I don't know because I didn't get to go and you couldn't record.
Oh, if I heard that live, I'd cry. I would literally be crying if I heard her sing the real folk blues live.
Yeah. The soundtracks to that anime are just great. Like, I remember I imported the one for the Cowboy Bebop movie, like, when I was in high school. Like, I got it off a website and had them, like, mail it to me, and I would just listen to it. My dad would be like, what are you listening to? I'm like, don't worry about it, Dad.
Don't worry about it, Dad. Leave it alone. It's porn. Leave me alone.
Jeez. So on top of being a pro athlete, you've talked a little bit about, you know, being a dad, you've got kids. Have you been able to introduce any of your favorite shows to your kids yet? I don't know what their
They watch whatever I watch. I can't tell them to go in the room, can't tell them it's inappropriate. They watch whatever I watch and they laugh at some of the, you know, more risque stuff, which is hilarious to me. Cause I'm like, oh my gosh, why'd they draw her like that? And they're laughing like, oh my goodness, why is her butt showing? That's hilarious. You know what I mean? I'm like, man, to be a kid again, the word butt was funny. Yeah. Why aren't butts funny anymore? What happened to us? So anyway,
desensitized to butts, I guess. You know? Yeah, we have to keep upping the stakes. We've already passed the butt threshold.
Yeah, we're so far past laughing at butts. Yeah. But they really enjoy it. And like they go, so now they'll go and I'll look and I'll see some anime watched on my Netflix. I'm like, who's watching Yokai Watch? I'm like, oh, you know, that's the kids. And I remember I was watching a Pokemon episode. You know what I mean? I'm like, who's this werewolf that punched Blastoise? It's like, Dad, that's Lycan Rock. I'm like, I'm old now.
That's not the original 150. I don't know who that is. Like,
I barely know Mew. What are you kidding me? Like,
I used to be able to do the Poke Rap, but I can't anymore.
I had them down to the days. I believe Mewtwo was on Friday. You know what I'm saying? I had them down to the days. The boys will listen to it, and I kind of, now you got the song in my head, Pokemon. You know what I mean? Yeah. It was a good one, man. Oh, you know, but the kids really into it.
Yeah, they
love Pokemon. They love
I tried to show My Hero Academia. I've got a son who's 11, and I was like, okay, you're probably, you know, you're old enough. I can show you My Hero Academia, right?
Yeah.
And then, like the first episode, they introduce Mount Lady. You know, the lady who gets really big. And like her introduction, you know, she's like sticks her butt out, and my son's just like giggling, like you know, her butt's big or something like that. And I'm just like, I forgot.
Just my mom showed me a cartoon of some lady's butt in leotards, but it was cool because she was beating up a villain. You know, but.
Catwoman style stuff, you know. Catwoman was running around.
Yeah, name is Catwoman. There's no difference, you know. Yeah.
I saw Michelle Pfeiffer in that movie when I was young, and I, you know, was confused for a little bit, but it, you know, works out.
You know, it definitely was some good stuff. I'm not gonna lie.
I guess the last question I'd like to ask you today is, what anime character do you think best represents your play style?
Damn. Okay. All right. It's almost an amalgamation of a few of them, but I will give the one who I would have to really, this guy gets my props is, damn, it's too many of them. Right. So, can I just like name just a couple?
Yeah.
All these guys are my dads. I got like 8 dads. I got like 8 anime dads who I'm on my game. Right. Okay. Right. Okay, cool. Kenshiro, number one. I just love his, he's just a super chill, cool guy, and I think it's because he knows he can kill you by poking you on the side of your shoulder.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And making your ears explode or something crazy like that. I mean, he made a dude walk backwards off of a ledge with no hands, right? So, but I just like his attention to detail. He's a real technician, and as a football player, particularly as a defensive lineman, it's really a combat sport being a lineman. It's, you know, you watch, like, oh, look, the fat guys running to each other. No, there's a lot of hand work. And my technique coach actually he built our training off of karate and wrestling and boxing.
Oh, cool.
You know what I mean? And it has really helped me out as a defensive lineman with leverage, hand placement, how to take a guy, torque his body, things like that. So Kenshiro is really – he's a real technician. And his techniques, they work. I mean, yeah. You can ask the thousands of the guys whose heads he's made explode. You know, they can probably tell you the same thing, but I don't think they're in shape to do that right now. Kenshiro for sure. I like Yusuke. I really like Yusuke Urameshi. And he was just a tough kid who knew how to fight. He was a street, like, he just knew how to fight in the streets. And then he realized he had powers, and now he's just a tough dude knows how to fight in the streets with powers. And I like how he has like a no prisoners, no bull crap. I don't care who you are, I'm beating you attitude. And that's the attitude I take. Like, I can play against the best lineman in the league. It doesn't matter, man. I'm taking that. I'm going to beat the crap out of you attitude that Yusuke has, right? Yeah. And Kid Boo, the small, the little Majin Boo. Yeah. My dad saw a poster of Tall Boo, and he said, oh, man, this is Majin Boo's little brother, huh? I'm like, no, not quite. But, you know, I appreciate you paying attention, Pop. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. That's my dog. That's my dude, man. But Kid Buu, because Piccolo wanted to take over the world, so, you know, the Saiyans, Frieza, so I'm gonna blow up the planet Earth and talk 20 episodes before I do it, dude. Just imagine Buu, Kid Buu, he got reincarnated, stood there maybe a minute, didn't even take the time to look around, created a little pink thing and blew up the planet. No talking, no nothing. He just blew up the planet.
Was he just mad that he was there? Like, who brought me here? I didn't ask this.
I don't know if he was mad. I think he just did it just because. He unintentionally achieved every villain's goal. Blow up the Earth. Boo. What? I just blow things up, period. So that type of savagery, right? Mm-hmm. They say he's not the strongest Boo. Super Buu absorbed with Gohan, and then as the main form, and then Piccolo, Gotenks.
Yeah.
He's the strongest Buu, but Kid Buu, the little Buu, original Buu, pure Buu, he's the most dangerous.
Okay.
He's the most dangerous. See what I'm saying? Because once again, the guy was reincarnated and instantly blew up the planet. So that type of savagery of, like, look at the fight with him and Goku. Nothing was phasing him, even though it hurt. He was beating his chest. Goku kneed him in the face. He just kept beating his chest. No big deal. So that's kind of where I like his savagery, and that's just something that I really take on the football field with me, right? A calculated technician who has a no-prisoners attitude and brings the savagery with the calculated techniques. It's pretty dangerous.
Yeah. You put all that in there, and then you put on your Berserk soundtrack, and then you just go.
Berserk soundtrack, and also I have to be inspired by Dragon Ball for the training.
Yeah,
you know, like my trainer, we actually have bands that he puts on me. If you look at my YouTube, my social media, I have heavy bands that I can't move, and yet he forces me to work through those. And he said, Mike, I actually got this idea from Dragon Ball with the weighted clothing and the gravity chamber. I said,
that was my gravity chamber when you were describing it. Like that.
I'm training at 100 times Earth's gravity, okay? That's why I'm getting so much better each year.
Nice.
Yeah, the gravity room was his best influence, really.
Yeah. Well, Mike, I want to thank you so much for making the time to talk with me today. We went over Tenchi, we went over Dragon Ball, we went over Sailor Moon, we went over everything. It was just like a cool trip down South Lane, like chatting with you today. It was so cool. So listen, thank you so much.
I can love this all day. Thank you. Thank you for having me. You know, it's a piece of my anime collection here. I just had to stand in front of it so the people can see it, you know. But I really had a blast today. Looking forward to next time. I mean, as you can see, we could talk this forever.
Yeah, I could check in with you every season and say, what's Mike watching this season? What's Mike recommend this season? Recommendations straight from Mike Daniels. It'd be great.
Yes. Please, people, give me some recommendations. We read comments, okay? What's recommendations?
All right, cool. Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
I want to thank Mike Daniels for coming out to the show today. I also want to thank all of Anime News Network's fans for tuning in. If you want more anime content in your inbox, click the links below to join the ANN newsletter. We've got all the top stories in the anime industry, editorials, reviews, everything to satiate your otaku appetite. We've also launched our first line of exclusive ANN gear, including shirts and coffee cups over at Kaimono Merch. Remember to come back here every Monday for the Titanic Attack on Titan After Show with myself, Jackie Jing, and reviewer James Beckett. See you guys again soon!
Sailor Moon calendar?
Oh yeah. Okay.
That's awesome.
I gotta show you something. This is what I've had.
Please, please do.
Okay. It's one of the original ones. All right. So yeah. Still does the battery's still working it and everything. So wait, can you see this? All right.
Yeah,
so.
I can. Oh my gosh.
The batteries are dead, but it plays all the little songs and stuff, and you push the buttons and like lights up in the crown.